Christian Whiton is that expert and former senior advisor in both the Trump and Bush administrations. And this is Christian's wheelhouse, and he joins us this afternoon. Thank you so much for your time. It's good to be with you. What concerns do you have? And I know it's I always like to give the benefit of the doubt to incoming administrations, regardless of whether we are on the same side politically, which obviously I am not with the Biden administration. But I realize that it can be kind of like a bumpy turnover sometimes. There's a lot of things at play, a lot of cooks in the kitchen. But some of these are pretty big bumps, like the Twitter bio thing with Israel. And then, of course, this report that came out. This was Jerusalem Post that reported the situation about the bombing in Baghdad and whether or not we are going to recommit a reversal of the winding down of our presence that we saw under the Trump administration. What concerns you just about what you've seen in the first, you know, 3 days here of the Biden administration with all of the with all of this?
Right. Well, it concerns me most, actually, is that, you know, Senator Daines said you may have a policy of Saudi Arabia first, that especially the moves on energy. And, you know, these are the people who are supposed to understand diplomacy, unlike us knuckle draggers on the right. These are the people who understand multilateralism. Well, what did Joe Biden do first was to cancel the Keystone XL pipeline without any consultation with one of our most important allies and neighbors is Canada. And then you have these other moves. You have, you know, Vladimir Putin wanted a 1-year extension on the START treaty. That's a nuclear treaty we have with Russia. Joe Biden saying, oh, just go ahead and have 5 years, actually. I mean, where are these people when you want to sell a used car? It's not the best negotiating. It's one thing if you want to talk to the Russians and deal with the Russians, and I think we should when it makes sense, but to do it and give away things in exchange for nothing. Same with the Paris Climate Accords.
Yes.
Rejoining those without any sort of modification or request, and that doesn't just raise the price potentially of gas and electricity. It raises the price of everything. Housing, education, food, everything. So my biggest concern is these people are just trying desperately to turn back the clock to 2015 and don't know how to drive a hard bargain.
Yeah. And you make a really good point, too, about the Paris Agreement, which the previous President Obama sidestepped the Senate on that. And I'm still trying to figure out how we're able to commit to so important of a thing and put our economy basically in the hands of Europe and have them make all these determinations for the sake of climate without actually bringing the biggest polluter in the world, China, to the table and having them make concessions. That makes no sense. But on the Iran agreement, too, or rejoining the Iran deal, so to speak, there was something that Jen Psaki had said, and I think this may have been day one, maybe it was yesterday. It's been a lot in her press conference when she was talking to reporters. And there were even some reporters that I think would identify as being on the left side of the political sphere that were a little curious as to what she meant when she was discussing how they may have to, you know, there was no reevaluation of terms, but they were talking about an extension for this or that, or, and no one was quite sure if she was talking about us reevaluating things on our end or looking at how Iran has been meeting the deal, and which they haven't never been. I mean, we know that, and evaluating things on their end. It was just very vague, and it made for more questions than anything else.
Right. And that's, of course, the special of Jen Psaki. She was at the State Department under Hillary Clinton, along with Marie Harf. Harf at least came from the CIA and knew a little bit about subject matter, whereas Psaki was just, I don't know, maybe someone who drove a van on the campaign or something. So, you know, a lot of arrogance. That's one thing. These people were never put through the test, if you will, by the media during the campaign, because the media essentially ran the campaign. You never heard about the DNC. You never really heard about campaign spokesmen. You heard journalists basically doing the fighting for them. So they're really rusty on debate and on making points. We saw this also when, you know, asked why President Biden wasn't wearing a mask on federal property, which he had just ordered. Oh, he's too busy to follow his own order. You know, a lack of clarity. And that's, I think, also a byproduct that they really don't have a clear foreign policy other than they're not Donald Trump. And they also bought the mythology of Trump, the fact, the sort of accusation, false accusation that Trump was unilateral, that he didn't consult allies, when in fact he consulted allies that matter, allies like Japan or Saudi Arabia or Gulf allies, etc. He may not have spent too much time dwelling upon what's going on in the salons of Europe, which I think John Kerry as climate envoy and Joe Biden will care about. But just sort of a lot of sloppiness here.
Climate envoy. I mean, even having that kind of influence or even a make-believe position like this in the White House is amazing to me. This story that, and I'm not a conspiracy theorist. Let me lay that out. Like, I'm not a conspiracy theorist. I'm not going to put a tinfoil hat on. But there are some things that are on the table right now, and I'm just kind of looking at them thinking, this is weird. I mean, you mentioned the Keystone Pipeline and how now that's, I mean, Warren Buffett celebrating today. I mean, his rail lines are, I mean, he's going to be making buku bucks, more money with that. Canada's upset, costing thousands of jobs. It strained our relationship with Canada, and Trudeau for all of his problems, you know, leader of Canada. I mean, we don't want to have that kind of relationship in a new administration right off the bat. But the move to stop the fracking and all of this other stuff on public lands. And then now there was, and I mentioned the story of Syria. Syrian state news agency SANA is reporting large convoy of American trucks, armored vehicles, helicopters entering the country yesterday. Again, not a conspiracy theorist, and I don't even want to go up to that speculation just yet. Again, we're in that first week benefit of the doubt thing. But we're seriously not giving the optic of trying to do everything we can to diminish our own energy output here in the United States while then increasing our presence in oil-producing areas overseas, are we?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, the sort of where people talk conspiracy, I look for incompetence. And I do worry, especially with General Austin, who is sort of absolutely the wrong person at the wrong time and the wrong place to be our Secretary of Defense at a time where we need to be focused increasingly on China. But still keep an eye on Iran and certainly on Russia as well. You know, we have a Secretary of Defense whose specialty is sort of in these cowboys and Indians, endless sideshow wars in the Middle East. And you wonder if, the current commander of Central Command was just waiting for this handover to go and try and create some relevance and activity in his area of responsibility, when in fact we should be looking to transfer all of those responsibilities and bring our forces back home from the Middle East, if possible, certainly from Europe, where it's been, 70 years since the end of the war plus. And we have people who are just, there because they're there. So I think there's probably a little bit more of incompetence, and maybe some similar to the change of the description of our ambassador in Israel. My guess is that was someone at the embassy there who just thought, gee, Donald Trump is gone. Let's go back, to 2015 and the way we looked at sort of Israel with the hands off, and that, we're balancing the Palestinian and the Israelis, even though, frankly, even Arab states have started to dispense with the fiction that they are in favor of the Palestinians and their terrorist government. So, I think just a lot of giddiness and some incompetence in the bureaucracy.
We're talking with Christian Whitlock, who was foreign policy advisor for both Trump and Bush administrations. Christian, last question for you. One of the biggest accomplishments from the Trump administration, of course, was the Abraham Accords. This was something that we never thought we would see, just, the telecommunications being developed and the direct flights. And then, of course, we saw the moving of the embassy to Jerusalem, which the Biden administration at least said they're not going to move it back, so to speak. I mean, we're not going to have that switch, every single time we get a new president, thank heavens. But I am worried about the progress of having other Arab states join these accords, particularly now that we have an administration that seems to give great favor to Iran, at least if they continue with that. They have all the previous foreign policy people who operated with that preference in mind now in the Biden administration. What is your thought on that? And is this going to be severely hampered now?
I think it will, because I think there's going to be such a strong move to get something from Iran. You have Wendy Sherman as the Deputy Secretary of State. She was in previous stints at the State Department. The first one was under Bill Clinton, and she made the deal of the century with North Korea. It was a great deal for them, gave them tons of energy assistance that was easily converted into cash, helped them build a nuclear reactor. They promised to give up their nukes. They didn't. Then in the Obama administration, she was the chief architect of the flawed Iran nuclear deal. So this is a group that's going to really want something out of Iran, whether they outright betray Israel or just put the emphasis elsewhere. So rather than following through and say, you know, that we should have other Muslim majority states recognize Israel, leaning on Saudi Arabia, having a relationship with Saudi Arabia, and Saudi Arabia does a lot of things that are annoying, but they're an important factor in that region, and getting them to recognize Israel would really be a big achievement. And also Muslim majority countries elsewhere, like Indonesia and Malaysia, Brunei, that don't recognize Israel. So whereas I think you would have seen continued progress and pressure from a Trump administration, now you have Israel looking and other countries on the forefront of, frankly, the fight against tyranny, countries like Taiwan, wondering if, you know, an ally has just gone soft and if they're going to get any help. And I think the answer is, you know, Israel can always go to Congress, but it's going to be much tougher sledding for our allies, the allies that matter, you know, mm-hmm. Brussels, Belgium, France, etc. They'll do fine in the Obama and the Biden administration, but other allies will have a tougher road.
It is kind of easy to kind of think that the Biden administration is, because I myself have been thinking that Biden administration, because so many people are holdovers. They've just like, they kept them to the side and brought them back. It's like the same faces again after 4 years.